setup here.
Thank you to all of you for being here today for the session Collector of Worlds, a conversation with Ilya Choyanov. We are very privileged to have this Bulgarian-German author with us here because he's really a very renowned voice in the world of literature and also as a champion of freedom of speech and human rights. So we are going to have a very interesting session today talking with Ilya about his book, The Collector of Worlds, which is right here, published several years ago now, but new to me, and probably new to many of you readers here in Pakistan, of particular interest to us because this book is about selected episodes from the life of Sir Richard Burton, the colonial era British traveler, explorer, officer, spy. But before we get done, started with this conversation, we need to take a moment to remember somebody who was very important to this festival and to Sindh, who passed away this morning, and that is Dr. Hamida Koro. Dr. Koro was, unfortunately, after a period of illness, Dr. Koro was a very important voice, a great lady of Sindh, an educator, a historian, a writer, the superb translator of a world that is beloved by all of us, even though we may not all be familiar with it. She brought Sindh to this festival, and she took Sindh to the world with her beautiful series of children's history books published by OUP. So we'll just take a minute to remember her in silence before we begin. I'll also take this moment to please ask you to turn your mobile phones off or switch them to silent. And now we will get started with the session. So welcome, Ilya.
Thank you. Good to be here.
How does it feel, actually, to finally be in a land that you have written about?
Well, it feels wonderful because I've always wanted to take the book to all the places in which it is set. And I've taken it to East Africa. Mm-hmm. I've taken it to Egypt. I've taken it, of course, to India and to London. And Sindh was the last remaining white patch on this literary map, so I'm very happy.
Do you have a ritual with the book? Do you place it in an important place and maybe hang some flowers around it? Or
no, not at all. No, I kind of prefer reading books and not kind of making them into an idol.
Well, let me tell our audience a little bit about you. And I'm reading this straight from the program, but it sounds better when it's spoken aloud than read. German author and founder of the Munich Literature Festival, Ilya Choyanov is a protean personality. Born in Sofia, Bulgaria in 1965, he fled with his family to political asylum in Germany in 1971. In 1972, the family moved to Nairobi, Kenya, where he lived until 1984. After a stint in Paris, he studied law and ethnology at Munich University. While there, he successfully founded two publishing houses, both specializing in African literature. In 1999, Choyanov moved to Mumbai and wrote about Indian life and culture. He's since lived in Cape Town, returned to Germany, and then moved to Vienna, Austria. Choyanov has written several nonfiction and travel books about Africa. He's published an anthology of contemporary African literature and translated African authors into German. His first novel, The World is Big and Salvation Lurks Around the Corner, was published in 1996. After that, he published the science fiction novel Autopol, Hunde Zeiten, Homecoming in a Foreign Country, and books dealing with his experiences in India. He's also taken part in the Hajj pilgrimage, of which he wrote into the holy sources of Islam as pilgrims to Mecca and Medina. In March 2006, his novel, The Collector of Worlds, was published, and it won the Leipzig Book Fair Prize. It was on the European bestseller list for months. And since then, he's also written other books such as Eistal and a book called Mein Olympiad, which is very interesting, about trying out all the 84 sports in the Olympic Pantheon. So if we have a little time at the end, maybe we can talk about that too. But so welcome, Ilya. Please, let's give him a big hand. I'd like to start by going into this book, The Collective Worlds, which is about the life of Sir Richard Burton, the traveler and explorer from Britain. And the novel is interestingly constructed in three parts because Burton lived a huge and rich and varied life. So you chose to focus on three parts of his life: his early days as an officer in India, stationed in Gujarat and Sindh, then his pilgrimage to Mecca, starting from Egypt, and finally his expedition in Tanzania to discover the source of the Nile. And I want to ask you, why those three episodes? What was your choice in whittling it down to those three parts of his life when he did a lot more than that?
Well, I have to go back to my childhood, because when I was 10, my parents gave me a book that basically was an anthology about the great travelers in Africa. Mm. And all these mostly British and French travelers looked the same, except for one person who was clad in long Arab cloth. And I was fascinated by this person because he seemed to be so different. So from then I developed a fascination with the character. And many years later I thought to myself that his story needs to be retold through the perspective of the other. Because basically the colonial enterprise has always been, especially in discourse, reflection, and representation, has been a one-way street.
Oh yes.
And growing up in Africa, I noticed that books that European write about Africa never ever include a main African character, even less an African narrator, and the other way around as well. When African literature hit its stride around independence, 60s, 70s, the European characters were as much a caricature as the other way around.
Oh yes.
And I thought to myself, it's high time that I try to establish a kind of narrative justice. Mm. So to have a novel that carries the voices from different parts of life, from different perspectives, from different backgrounds, and thus to come up with a narration that is more balanced than the previous one. So that was the initial idea.
Right.
And because I knew East Africa, I knew I had to go to India. So I moved to Bombay. I thought I would stay a year. Mm. And then South Asia has this habit of grabbing you and not letting you go. So I stayed nearly 6 years there. And it became evident that it has to be a kind of triathlon. It has to be, it has to have three different phases of discovery, of immersion, and then of alienation. So this is basically how the story is structured.
So India is the phase of discovery.
Exactly.
And Egypt and Mecca is the phase of immersion. Yeah. And then the alienation comes in the African chapter of the story. And I must say that this book in tone is extremely intense. It's gripping. I struggled, actually. And I think you captured me in a way with Burton's struggle by putting the reader through her own struggle in trying to understand this person and trying to grasp the concepts, because it's also a book of ideas. Burton is described as a strange and brooding genius and a revolutionary of his time.
It's a book of ideas, but it's also, I think, a very physical book.
Yes.
And one of the things that I found intriguing was how you can put your body on the line. So the colonial enterprise as also a physical exercise, mm-hmm. Both in terms of repression, torture, as well as allowing yourself and your own body to go beyond the limits of what you believe you can endure. So in order to get a sense of that, I actually walked in his footsteps through Tanzania. So that's from the coast, Bagamoyo, along the old historical caravan route all the way to Lake Tanganyika. And the interesting thing was that you could actually, when you read this book, I only had one book in my rucksack because I had to carry everything. So when you read this book and you looked at the landscape, you could actually see how incredibly precise his description is. Mm. And at the same time, what I discovered is that until I did that journey, I hadn't actually traveled. I realized that the only way to travel intensely is on foot, number one. Number two, alone. And number three is expose yourself radically. No safety net. So when you're walking through Africa, it's that kind of... So that allowed me to enter also in both what I mentioned, the alienation aspect, but also in the physical excruciating challenge of travel in the 19th century. And of course, travel for most of us nowadays is an extremely comfortable exercise.
Yes.
And when you look at the travel industry, you might say that its only justification is to disallow travel. It actually stands in the way of real travel. So those were many of the aspects in which the literary form came out of the radical research.
Yes.
That very often happened. Yes. With this novel.
Yes, yes. No, what you say is ringing absolutely true for me, because this is some of the most intensely physical writing as well that I think I've read, especially the part in Africa, the illnesses that they go through. And I mean, literally, you will feel your own skin crawling when Ilya describes bug infestations, malarial fevers, and the back break. I was amazed that they actually survived, both of them, because Burton had a traveling companion, Jack Spake, and they both nearly died several times over. Did that happen to you on this journey?
Well, yeah, there were a few slightly difficult moments, yeah.
Close calls, maybe. Yeah. And so when you came out of that, did you feel that you had become Burton in a way? Did you feel that you understood him better?
No, because I actually didn't want to do that. The longer I researched him, the more I felt distant to him.
Uh-huh.
And in a way, I became closer to his Indian servant, Naukaram.
Yes.
To the African guide, Sidi Mubarak Bombay.
Yes.
Now, Sidi Mubarak Bombay is a really, really fascinating character.
Yes, tell us a little bit about
him. And people here in Karachi might know a little bit about this group of people, the African Indians, so the Sidis.
Yes.
And there's a part in Bombay, there's a Mwala in Bombay, where they have their Durga, and they've developed a kind of very weird religion of their own, in that they claim that Bilal is the last prophet.
Correct.
Because, of course, he was African.
Correct.
So they have this weird mix of Islam and animist African religions.
Yes.
In this Durga in the middle of Bombay. And there's still a few thousand. So the other big center of the cities is in mm-hmm. in Karachi and in the Sindh. And the story is that they were taken as slaves from East Africa, taken to South Asia. And what I didn't know was that they lost their names, and they were given names very often of the places where they arrived, mm-hmm. which is why Sidi was then called Sidi Bombay and Mubarak,
right.
for evident reasons.
Correct.
So when the Banya who owned him, when he died, he set him free. So he goes back to Africa, and he becomes the first independent travel guide in African history.
That's
so he offers his services to all these different British expeditions. Now, the interesting thing is he was the guide to the four most important expeditions. And, of course, these Britishers don't mention him except in a few footnotes. And basically, he made this phase of exploration possible because, as you can easily imagine, if you are walking through a country that you've never been to before, it's quite difficult to find your way. So he was the guy who basically took them into the interior of Africa, and yet he is written out of history. And the interesting thing is even the African historians, after independence, never ever looked at him, not only at him, but also at the whole infrastructure of exploration, which of course was also African.
Yes.
Or there was a tribe called the Nyamwezi, who actually specialized in carrying goods for the caravans. So all these people are written out of history. So it's the famous poem by Bertolt Brecht, "Caesar occupied France or Gaul. Didn't he at least have a cook with him?" And it's the same kind of thing. You know, we always talk about these explorers. And what about this huge set of, in his case, of about 120 people who actually literally carried Speke and Burton through Africa? Because,
yes.
as you said, there were. So I thought to myself, it would be so wonderful if I could go back in time with a microphone and ask Sidi to tell his story. Mm. So this was kind of the beginning of... And also what you have here is you have in a very complex modern novel, are going back to orality. Because in the African chapter, of course, at that time, there was no written literature. It was all oral.
Yeah.
So he comes from this oral tradition, while, of course, the Indian chapter would be an interaction between écriture, what you write down, and orality. So that is another of the subtext in the novel. And then additionally, you have different, I don't know whether you noticed that, you have different frameworks of time. Because the interesting thing is that these three cultural regions have different time concepts.
Correct.
So the Hindu one, of course, is circular. The Islamic one, like the Christian one, goes from the beginning to the end.
Linear.
And it has, of course, years, and it has chronology, and it has linearity. And the African one is fragmented.
Yes.
You do not have, in traditional African philosophy, you do not have a sense of a time continuum. So the only thing you can, the only way you would demarcate historical or personal events would be by linking them to something that happened. So you would not say it was this or that year.
Somebody was born.
Exactly, it was the year somebody was born. And because you do not have the continuum, the tomorrow and the yesterday can easily change. So you would never kind of set up a story within the framework of chronology. So this is the way the three chapters are also structured in a different time way.
Mm. So much to unpack and talk about there. You've set off more questions in my mind than the ones that I have written down. But indeed, you are talking counter-narrative and counter-narrative. So there's Burton's narrative, where he's relating what we know as the main story of his life. And then you have the counter-voice. So in the first part, it's Nokaram, the servant of Burton, who was released by Burton and sort of lived the rest of his life in ignominy. In the second part, you have a very nice tension going on. Burton is telling his tale of traveling in disguise to Mecca. But at the same time, then you have an investigation going on with the officials, the Sharif of Mecca, being questioned by the Ottoman official. How did this happen? How did this Englishman and spy come here? And you foreshadow very nicely the tension that arises from the overlords of the Ottoman Empire and the Arab wish to later regain control over their own land. So that was a very nice thing that you were doing there in that dialogue. And then, of course, with Sidi Mubarak, you raised a lot of questions, very interesting ones, about the role of Arab Muslims in the African slave trade, because you related so much of Sidi Mubarak's experiences as a slave. And by the way, in Pakistan, we have Shidis as well, who are the descendants of the African slaves. So what you're actually doing is, in the words of Gayatri Spivak, you are letting the subaltern speak.
Absolutely, yeah. That's one of the aspects. The other one is I truly believe that novelists are alternate historians.
Yes.
And I think that since we're not bound by academia and we're not bound, I think we're freer in how we can approach certain subjects and certain epochs, that we can actually look at those parts of history that have been either overlooked or purposely written out of history. Now, the interesting thing is that everybody knows a lot about the slave trade across the Atlantic. And in both academic books and popular books, it's been, and in literature, it's been very well covered. While the other part of the slave trade across the Indian Ocean is still hardly researched. It's basically still something that has not been looked into seriously. And then at the same time, it has, I think, profound effects on countries around the African Horn and on the different Arab countries along the seaboard of the Indian Ocean. So I thought that it might be very interesting within the limits of a novel to reflect upon that.
Yes, absolutely. It's a piece of missing history, I think, that we in our Muslim worlds have not yet confronted and come to terms with. There's been no, for example, as in the West, there's been no attempt at apology, at reparations, anything of the sort. And we sometimes use the excuse that, well, the Islamic system of slavery is not the same as in the West. We were kinder and we looked upon them as sons. But Sidi Mubarak's own testimony shows that that's not quite how it seems. So we even have to think of ourselves, or the Arabs have to think of themselves as much as colonialists as the British or other Western countries. Can we have that door shut, please, in the back? Please keep it closed. Thank you very much.
Well, there are many testimonies in East Africa, very much in the Sudan, for example,
yes,
that it basically resembled a form of genocide. The Arab slave traders were very, very brutal, certainly not less than the European ones. And I think you can only start overcoming the traumata of any society by first accepting certain realities,
yes,
and taking these realities into an open discourse. And that has yet to happen, interestingly enough.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're in a huge form of denial about this.
Absolutely.
I think. And what effect do you think that denial has on the health of Arab nations or Muslim nations as a whole?
Well, it's interesting that one of my closest friends is a novelist from Somalia, Nuruddin Farah. And it's interesting that time and again he tells me that there's this sense amongst East Africans that the Arabs are very racist. And I asked him to explain this to me, and he said that it is basically partly influenced by an age-old resentment. So even if it's not embodied in current behavior, mm-hmm, it is kind of part of a historical stream of, as you said, both denial and violence not healed, that East Africans feel towards. So there's a lot of interestingly enough, that's one of the things which the West hardly ever reflects upon,
mm,
because since 9/11 we've had this representation of the Islamic world as a hegemony, as a uniform universe, and all these really, really complicated conflicts within the Islamic world, for example, between Muslim East Africans and Muslim Arabs, one of many, many, many conflicts, are hardly ever looked at. And of course, the ongoing conflict, which is also part, I think, of the book, the ongoing conflict of radicals against Sufism.
Yes.
Because the point of introduction, the interface that enables Richard Burton to enter Islam in a form of both fascination and frustration,
mm,
is, of course, Sufism.
Yes.
And in Germany, at least, there's a really, really, really frustrating denial that the ongoing campaign of extermination is, above all, one against Sufism and against the incredible beauty and wealth of the Sufi tradition. So these are many of the aspects which, in a way, make the novel, I think, quite contemporary.
Yes.
Although it is set in the 19th century.
No, everything resonated for me as a person with experience of Islam and of the conflicts that are going on between our two very polarized worlds. Everything seemed like it could have been a modern narrative, really.
Yeah. You know, the funny thing was he came to Bombay just after the end of the Afghan campaign.
Yes.
And of course, you know, that was the big, big disaster of British military history. They really got, excuse me, their backside whipped. And I think there's still all these interventions are, in a way, the British trying to win that one big, to win back that one big defeat. The interesting thing is, because of that, I read the reports by the generals from 1842, 1843.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was doing that, so that was 2001, 2002, 2003 in Bombay, of course, the war against Afghanistan started.
Oh.
And I'm really not exaggerating. There were certain press conferences by British and American generals where nearly verbatim the same things were repeated that were said 1842. And I was sitting there and I was thinking, in 116 years, these fellows have not learned anything. And isn't that part of the problem? Isn't kind of the whole idea of humanity to learn from previous cases and to come up with new solutions? And it was all the same mistakes and crimes repeated time and again.
I heard yesterday a quote, which I'm misquoting now, but somebody said in one of the sessions that history is another word for humanity's inability to deal with its own violence.
Mm.
It's not an exact quote.
No, but I can relate to that.
Yeah, yeah. I would like to ask you about the actual character of Richard Burton himself. How easy or how difficult was it to build a three-dimensional person out of his writing, his accounts? The opening scene of the book is the one in which his wife, Isabel, at the end of his life, or did it happen after he died? She
yes.
burned everything that he had his notebooks,
the things he was working, the personal notebooks,
translations for more books, so on and so forth. So how difficult was it for you to build this person out of what there was left?
It was probably the most difficult thing because I wanted to distance myself from the historical figure.
Yes.
Now, the interesting thing is we have a very simplified, oversimplistic view that nonfiction and fiction are clearly separated. Now, there are 12 biographies on Richard Burton, and you would think that as nonfiction, they have a certain historical accuracy and veracity. Yet, when you read one, it says the marriage between Burton and Isabel was one made in heaven. And the other biography says, never were two people less suited to one another than these two. So you're reading these biographies, and they differ on all important aspects, all important subjects. So you're thinking to yourself, actually, there's not that big a difference between fiction and nonfiction. Different narrations, of course, different instrumentations. But there's always a circling around the black hole of the unknown, of what cannot be said.
Yes.
And the only way you can demarcate the unsayable is by basically constructing a reality around it.
Correct.
And I think that in a way novels are better at doing that because they accept the fact that you have, let's be maybe slightly provocative, truths that you cannot depict, and therefore it has to be done in, like you do it in your own novel, it has to be through a collage of fragments and scenes that in a way extrapolate
yes.
what cannot be directly said.
That's right.
And I think that is one of the great strengths of a novel, while a nonfiction book, a historical book, claims, or at least tries to claim, that it has a correct representation of history.
Yes, I think something that I'm only recently learning is that our great lie to ourselves is that history is objective, whereas novels are subjective. But
yeah.
I think you can have both.
Or you could say history is subjective while novels are objective.
You could have both and both, or you could recognize the subjectivity and objectivity in both forms. I was interested to ask you why you chose to write Burton's narrative in the third person rather than first.
Well, I think with every novel I write, the big question is who is given the voice?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you would agree with me that is one of the most important decisions that the novelist makes. Who is allowed to speak directly and who is being spoken about?
Yes.
That is a both philosophical and political decision of utmost importance. The other thing is that as a novelist, what I usually do is I distance myself from the people I might feel close to,
mm-hmm.
and I try to immerse myself in the people that I don't feel close to. So the last novel I wrote is called Power and Resistance, and it's about communist and post-communist reality in Bulgaria. And what I did is I took the officer, the senior officer from the Secret Service, who was involved in torture, murder, and all sorts of things, and I gave him a voice, which forced me to really enter this character, which was very, very tough. It was often close to traumatic because I felt disgusted mm-hmm. with myself and I was in a seriously bad mood after a day of writing from his point of view. But it was the only way possible of not making him a caricature, because if I had a third person narrator, I think I would be tempted to allow some form of moral judgment on him. And I think that's what you have to avoid in novels. The moral judgment comes, I think, from the instincts and the intelligence of the readers, not by the author imposing it on the readers.
What you're saying is in another way of saying that the author must be able to have empathy for the characters.
No, absolutely.
But how do you have empathy for somebody so horrible as a torturer?
Well, it's just hard work, I guess.
Yes.
I
mean, yeah. So what kind of mood were you in when you were writing this book?
It depends. I really fell in love with Sidi Mubarak Bombay, and it might show. So there was a sense of really embracing him and becoming one with him. With other figures, there was more of a struggle.
Yes.
But you know how it is. That's normal. Some figures are, in a way, you relate better to them, and it works out better than with others.
One of the most intriguing characters is one that we hear a bit from, but almost not enough, and that is Kundalini the prostitute in the first section in Burton's life in India.
Now, the interesting thing is, sorry to interrupt you, by saying she's a prostitute, you're already, of course, making a judgment. So the interesting thing is she one or is she not one?
Because I didn't want to spoil it for the readers, you know, just
okay.
in case.
So you want them to find out that she might not be one?
If I reveal it all, then what's to read?
Very good point. I agree with you.
We could call her his companion.
Yeah, it's kind of one of the many things which are... I think the novel is full of spaces of ambivalence. Mm. And it's very unclear what their relationship really is. It's both a material interaction.
Yes.
As well as an emotional... connection.
And I was surprised to see the emotionality of the connection, given that Burton was known as the great, you know, his sexual exploits and his interest in the sexual practices of the mysterious East. Obviously, that's what Western audiences lapped up.
Yeah, but you know that people who talk a lot about sex are those who don't have enough of it.
Yes,
so.
I've been told. I've been told that before. I also really enjoyed that one little sliver of conversation where Sidi Mubarak's wife is telling her side of the story. And that's, you give the subaltern the voice in terms of the colonialized men, and that's an instance where you give yet another colonialized population, that is the women, a moment in which to speak. Why didn't you do more of that?
Yeah, that's a very good point. And I have been criticized by... female readers, that I didn't do enough of it. There are certain practicalities and certain historical facts. So on the Hajj and then the investigation by the authorities could only have been done by men. It would have been a historical joke to include women there. On the journey, on the expedition to Africa, there were no women. So the only place where I could do it was in India with Kundalini. And Kundalini, in a way, paraphrases Scheherazade.
Yes, very
and,
much so.
I'm not going to tell you how because it's erotic, and then I don't want to spoil it for you. But
everybody's going to run out and buy this book now. You're going to be rushing.
That was clever of me, wasn't it?
Yes.
No, I can just tell you that some female readers in other countries thought that that the erotic scenes work actually very well. So that's a positive feedback. But I completely accept the criticism. I just think that with any novel of such a vast scope, as an author, you're afraid of drowning. You're afraid of being overwhelmed by the massive research. I mean, I did 5 years of research. I have a library of about 300 books connected to that book. Mm. I have about 20 notebooks. I was really, really afraid of expanding it too much. And Isabel Burton actually had 3 chapters in the first version, so I cut them out. So it's partly maybe a lack of sensitivity on the side of a male novelist. I would accept that. But also it's partly... the result of many practical decisions that you have to take as a novelist, where you limit yourself. Now, that is the beauty of the novel. That's why I think the novel is our highest form of cultural production, because it can include everything. But by being able to include everything, it forces you to make tough decisions, because the moment it does try to include everything, the novel fails.
Correct.
So in a way, you are seduced by eternal possibility, and yet you have to discipline yourself in a often very difficult and hurtful way.
It's heartbreaking when you have to actually cut things out that you loved writing about
and
wanted to be there so badly. I also want to ask, now you did say, you mentioned that the three parts of the novel are of the introduction, the immersion, and then the alienation. How does Burton himself change from one section to the next, or are we actually looking at three different Burtons?
Well, we're looking at three different Burtons, but at the same time, we're looking at three different representations of imperialism or colonial rule. And I think the interesting thing with the main character in the novel, that if the novel is to succeed, he has to have an individual life, so a plausibility. He has to be, as you said, three-dimensional. But at the same time, he has to be more than just himself. Because if he's just a freak, if he does not represent a certain class or a certain time in history, then people might say, why write about him at all? So I wanted Burton to be unique, but at the same time to represent a certain colonial experience.
Yes.
And the colonial experience, interestingly enough, in South Asia, was one that we always think there's progress in history. But actually, when you look at British colonialism in South Asia, the 18th century was much better than the 19th century. In the 18th century, there was a lot of cultural and personal interaction between officers and the local population. After the so-called mutiny or the first Indian uprising, there was a complete ghettoization. And it's interesting, one thing that I don't think enough people have written about is that the great Indian uprising in the middle of the 19th century nearly coincided with the first manual of racism, which is by a man called Knox. It's called Of Races of Man. Mm. So this is kind of the first book of a clearly ideological positioning of racism as the backbone of the imperial exercise.
Correct.
And I don't think that these two things are not related. And after that, there was absolutely no interaction whatsoever. So you had, of course, in the 18th century, many Britishers who went jungly, as they said, who went local.
Gone native.
Exactly, who went native. And that was lost completely in the 19th century. And because of that, then there was no sensitivity towards local affairs. And I think this was discussed today in a discussion at 11 about partition. In a way, all the accusations against British rule and its involvement in the tragedy of partition are a result of that. There was a huge alienation of the British colonial force from the localities and sensitivities of the country.
There's another interesting possibility to that change, and that is that in the early days of the colonialist adventure, nobody was bringing their wives out.
Absolutely. That was a practical reason.
They were more involved intimately, physically, and emotionally with Indian women.
Absolutely.
And then once the wives started coming out, that changed completely, and it was looked down upon. Otherwise, it was seen as the normality of colonialism.
To say the wives started coming in is nearly a euphemism, because they were actually brought in like sheep.
It was
an extremely demeaning exercise. They were basically bought in England, and only, of course, the most depressed and frustrated people would go on board a ship to go to Calcutta. So it was kind of a marketplace for finding and expediting women to lonely British officers.
And imagine their moods when they came out.
Exactly.
Here. So not a very happy enterprise at all.
No, I don't think you had a lot of happy marriages there. No.
What were Burton's demons? What were the demons driving him?
Yeah, you know the best. You know the best biography is titled "And the Devil Drives."
yes.
So he's full of demons.
Yeah.
The interesting thing is that it's unclear whether these demons were actually truly demons or whether he played up to them. So he basically, and this is of course, as we know, both in the Christian and in the Islamic tradition, an age-old phenomena that critical people, free thinkers, agnostics would use the devil as a kind of support system or as a symbol. So he plays around a lot with that. He basically really liked to provoke other people. He liked to go against the established grain. So when he was in Sindh, he was in a constant argument and confrontation with Napier. And basically he was allowed to break all the rules, because as a spy he was so effective, and the information that he gathered was apparently the best of any officer in Sindh. But at the same time, he just completely disregarded all the usual laws, regulations, conventions.
There's a great scene in the book where he, after a tragic incident, I won't reveal what it is, he actually starts inviting a bunch of monkeys to come live in his house with him, and shocks everybody because he's dressing them up and feeding them at the dinner table. And this is true. This actually is something that he did.
Also, he gives them the names of all the other officers.
That's
and
right.
This is the priest Postumus, and yeah.
Well, we could go on forever. You have so many things to share with us and so much to tell, but I would like us to have a short reading from you. Would you like to do that, and then we can open up to the floor for questions?
Well, I think since we're here, we have to read something from the Sindh chapter. Would that be appropriate?
I think you should do the erotic section. That would be more interesting.
No way. You started off by saying that some things are better read aloud than in silence. I think for the erotic sections, the opposite is true.
To each their own.
To each their own. Captain Walter Scott rammed the ranging pole into the ground. Its red and white stripes stood out against the barren landscape like prison clothes. The soil was a puffy skin stretched over black clay. Oh, you'll pick it up in no time, no time at all. It's as easy as playing patience. All you do is join the unknown to the known. We catch the landscape like a wild horse, but by technical means. We are, let's say, the second advance guard. First you conquer, then you survey. Our influence is writ on squared paper. I know you're cut up about not seeing any action. You shouldn't be so. The cartographical work that we are doing here is of enormous military significance. Whoever is caught in our net of coordinates is lost to his cause. Civilization has broken him in. Now, shut one eye and focus the other as carefully as possible. There's only one quality you need as a surveyor: precision, absolute precision. We surveyors are pernickety people, so be prepared for a certain amount of pedantry. There are two values to measure: distance and altitude, and of course the angle between a position and an elevation. And Dick, tell me, what's the definition of an angle? The distance between orthodoxy and heresy? Actually, the difference between two directions. So I was more or less right. Do you know what it means to be more or less right in mathematics, Dick? Why do I find it difficult to imagine you as a surveyor? Burton has been assigned to this unit because he had to be assigned somewhere, and because it would be easier for him to set out on his forays from the remote camps. He shuts his eyes. It's that time of day when one's thoughts turn to silt. How are you supposed to determine the exact position of a point when everything is shimmering? When he opens his eyes, he sees a dervish moving along the horizontal, a black robe, a patched cap. I am the one who flies alone. His eyes are set deep in a trough of coal, his hands adorned with monstrous rings. Burton shuts his eyes. When he opens them again, the dervish is dressed in green, the chains around his neck, silver and brass, fabric and ivory. I am the one who flies alone. His hair, beard, dyed an orangey brown like henna. Burton shuts his eyes once more, keeps them shut for a long time. He repeats all the alphabets he knows. Did you see him? He eventually shouts into the wind to his comrades. What's the value of the variable? They shout back. The dervish was not a solitary apparition. The closer they moved their triangles to the next village, the more often he passed at a safe distance, before Burton's measuring gaze. He was different every time. He never seemed to assume a form he had taken before. Strange that the others did not see him. Once Burton decided to follow him. He came to a mosque, at the side of which stood a mausoleum in a walled precinct with a narrow entrance thick with people, thick with excitement. He heard a song that drew him in, scraping at the plaster of a secret chamber of his being. He felt touched. A festival was in progress. The saint's tomb was charged with an immeasurable longing. The crowd absorbed him. Before he could reach the tome covered with embroidered green fabric, his attention was distracted. Opposite the little door through which the stooping pilgrims were passing, a few men were sitting on the ground, singing the song that had touched him. It sounded like a declaration of love for every living thing. The singer's voice, an unusual instrument that imparted a shrill, almost clownish note to the most serious of things, screwed itself up to a higher pitch, turning the song on a disc that rotated even faster. Suddenly the dervish looked him into the eye. The revolutions continued inside him. "Sit here," the eye said. "Tarry a while. We are all guests. We are all wanderers. Be one of us."
Ilya, that was absolutely beautiful, and as much a pleasure to hear as it was to read. Thank you very much. Now we're
Thank
going
you.
To open the floor to questions. Yes.
Thank you very much for this conversation and for this reading. It focused mostly on this one book, perhaps rightly so, but your description here, the capsule biography, covers other very interesting areas, from a science fiction novel to some other non-fiction, and you were telling me about a book on partitions and borders and conflicts. So I was wondering if you could tell us, as briefly as possible, about your other works besides this important book.
Okay, the other 17 books in 1 minute.
A minute and a half.
Yeah. None of them is about me. That's, I think, the only common denominator.
Which one?
Yeah, it's interesting that you would say that, because recently a few literary critics or academics have actually claimed that it's a disguised autobiography, which I didn't know myself, but...
Reincarnation, maybe.
Yes. But there is a strong political aspect to my work. So I've written time and again books that focus. One book, for example, which was quite a scandalous book and provoked a lot of discussion, particularly in Germany, was about the new upcoming surveillance state.
Oh.
As someone who comes, who came from a dictatorship, and actually our apartment where I grew up was bugged by the Secret Service. So I'm in this unique, because I received all the dossiers after 89, so I'm in this unique position to read what the adults were speaking when I was in the crib. But because of this background, I'm very, very, very sensitive to the way the state, or the deep state, basically has unbound powers, especially the development after 9/11. So that was one book that is very important to me, and that's been an ongoing struggle. So I've been very involved. I organized with a few of my colleagues an international petition by the authors of the world. We actually brought 1,000 authors together from nearly every country of the world, many, many Nobel Prize winners, to protest the ongoing surveillance, and basically to demand a very clear digital bill of rights, a universal digital bill of rights, which clarifies what are the rights of each individual to his data, because we have a universal Declaration of Human Rights that very clearly defines what are your rights in terms of your body, in terms of certain your freedoms and your defense against certain oppression. But it's a very unclear thing as regard to your data. And since we're moving more and more into a virtual world, the virtuality of your existence needs to be defended as well. And this is something that's very important to me. The other thing is I've done quite a lot of textbooks about the North-South divide, injustice, neoliberal globalization. One book is called The Redundant Human Being, which looks at the fact that with the twofold development of, on one side, extreme neoliberalism, on the other side, automatization, a growing number of people are becoming redundant. And basically, when you look at countries I know well, for example, Kenya or India, you have a huge, huge chunk of population that actually has no existence in the way things are developing, and there's no plan for these people, especially poor peasants. There's no plan for what role they can play in the future. And the novels are all very different. Basically, I think there are two kinds of authors. One is who digs a hole and then digs deeper and deeper and deeper until he's dug a very beautiful, very deep hole. And there are other people who are more like the nomads who walk from place to place and then dig small holes. So I'm more of a gatherer and walker. That's it.
Thank you, Asif Saab. Next question, the mic will be passed to you.
I want to know, what is your source of inspiration that has really motivated you to become a writer?
That's easy. When I was six, between six and seven, everything in my world changed three times. So Bulgaria, Italy, Germany, Kenya. Everything changes, huh? Language, culture, climate, food, smells, everything. So I think at the age of seven, I thought that change is normality and things staying the same, that's weird. I think that since then has motivated me. I feel very uncomfortable with any form of rigidness, with any form of identity. I think I'm comfortable with the dynamic, with the fluid, with the versatile, with the varied. So that, I think, has been my main motivation.
Any other questions? Yes, right over there.
Just want to know about your next project, about what you want to write.
Well, I'm currently working on two projects. One is I want to write a utopian novel, because there's, I think, too much of an apocalyptic mindset in the world at the moment. There's a beautiful sentence that more people can imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. So I would actually, I would like to write a positive novel, one that actually imagines a better world in a convincing, plausible way. That is my literary project. And my political project is a book on reassessing and re-evaluating the concept of aid. What is aid that is both sustainable and changes the structural inadequacies, as opposed to aid that in a way cements and empowers existing injustices. And this book I'm actually writing with the gentleman there in the back of the room. So those are the two current projects.
Thank you for that question. Yes, next.
All I wanted to ask.
Okay, go ahead. No, you take your turn and then we'll. No, go ahead.
One after the other.
Go ahead, ma'am, and then the next one.
I'm just.
Can you bring the mic close to your face?
In the present day, what do you think of the problems in Germany, since you've lived in Germany, with these millions of people drifting across, lost, bewildered, and Muslims?
Thank you. Excellent question.
Well,
very relevant.
It might surprise you. I don't actually think that the problem is that big. First of all, Germany is uniquely positioned to deal with this problem. Of course, there are many, many challenges, but then there are always challenges. But I don't think it's something that threatens the foundations of German society. Now, a lot has been written about the negative reactions by certain parts of the population. I think we also have to take into account that quite a large part of the German population has reacted very positively. And just when I look at the crowd I interact with, friends, acquaintances, nearly everybody is involved in some way, teaching German to refugees, helping out, getting involved and so on. So there's also a great solidarity movement. And one of the really frustrating things is that, of course, the media focuses on the very negative things, the right wing, the fascists and so on, protesting. There have been a few also violent crimes against hostels and refugees. But there has been, I think, far, far more positive reaction towards this challenge. And on a political level, I think that as long as we have such radical injustices in the world, migration is something that has to be. I mean, migration is the logical result of a completely unbearably unjust global system. So you can't basically accept the privileges of the neoliberal world and at the same time protest that migration is happening. You know, it's either, if you don't want migration, solve the big social issues. If you don't want to solve them, then you have to accept and live with migration. And the good thing, I'm ironically, in parentheses, the good thing about migration is that it forces people to look at certain issues. So since this phenomenon started in Germany, there's been a growing awareness of what are the reasons for this migration. So now if you've lived in Germany the last 2 years, if you read the newspaper regularly, you're nearly a specialist on questions like the Sahara and the growing of the desert and the loss of livelihood on the civil war in Syria and so on and so forth, because more attention is given to the root causes of this problem.
Okay. Yes, now you.
Actually, I want to ask, how long does it take for you to complete the project of one book? What is
okay,
your average time?
The shortest was 3 months, the longest was 7 years.
Oh,
somewhere in between.
Okay, that's wonderful.
We've got a question right there.
And in the coming decades, 2 or 3 decades, do you see the process of migration is reverse?
No, impossible.
Thank you.
Basically, an area that I'm very familiar with, which is West Africa, basically south of the Sahara, is one whole huge area of catastrophe, because there are not enough resources for people to survive. Basically, which is why the so-called Sahel zone is one continuum at the moment of violence and civil war and radicalization and so on. So, of course, people are going to flee. There is no, if you're asking about the immediate future, there's no solution.
In 2 or 3 decades, because of the self-instinct, the people living.
Yes, the world is changing so fast. I can't imagine what's going to be in 3 decades.
Okay,
I mean, 1 year ago, no one could have imagined Trump would be president.
We have time for one last question, and I'm going to give it to you right there. If you can pass the mic down to her. Now, this young lady in the front here. Yes. Yeah.
Good morning, or afternoon.
Or evening. Or night.
We have no sense of time anymore.
You mentioned, you talked a little bit about concern regarding automation and that leading to loss of jobs. And then you were also talking about writing a novel about a utopia. So is that a problem that you're looking to solve in that novel, or is that something that you're going to address?
Except that it's not a problem. I think it's a huge, huge chance, because automatization will liberate people from an incredibly stupid, monotonous job. When you look at human existence, when you think of how many people are caught up in a job that is utterly demeaning, that gives them absolutely no spiritual, emotional replenishment, which they basically just do to survive, and then you imagine that it's now feasible, it's technically imaginable, that most of these not only horrible but extremely dangerous jobs, like, for example, mining can be completely automated. When you think of, in Bulgaria, the average life expectancy of a miner in a uranium mine was 10 years. So you have loads of people around the world to do also very, very damaging and dangerous jobs. All of that can be automated. So I think there's a huge chance there. I actually think that's one of the driving forces that will make us change our economy and our society, because evidently you can't have just 20% of people working and the other 80% sitting around doing nothing. There has to be radical change which will come out of this development.
It's with great regret that I have to end this session. Thank you for being such a fantastic audience, and please, a warm hand for Ilya Choyunov.
No, thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you. And thank you. Thank you very much to Bina Shah. It was a great pleasure. Thank you.
Are you selling them?
We have to answer a question.